Many of us have just tuned in to Eintracht Frankfurt in the last few seasons. First, there was their shock victory in the DFB Pokal final, then their push towards the top of the table in Germany, and their Europa League run, boasting some highly sought-after talent that secured big money moves away from the club. But just three seasons ago, Frankfurt were lifeless, fighting for their lives in the Bundesliga, and had the challenge of rejuvenating their squad with a shoestring budget. Hey there, I'm Adrian from Rabona TV, welcome, and today we'll look at how Eintracht Frankfurt turned their club fortunes around, first on the pitch, and then financially as well. As per usual though, you can't hold me back from giving you just a bit of a historic context. Eintracht Frankfurt was founded in 1899, or at least the two clubs that combined to create Eintracht Frankfurt were founded in 1899. Based in, of course, Frankfurt, one of the financial hubs of Europe, titles in Eintracht Frankfurt have been more acquaintances than fast friends in their long history. They've been champions of Germany just once, back in 1959, the pre-Bundesliga era, but they've had much more success in the DFB Pokal with five titles to their name. Any European success? Well, they won the Intertoto Cup in 1967, and after winning the 1959 German Championship, they made it all the way to the final of the European Cup, but couldn't stop Real Madrid from winning their fifth title, losing, well, 7-3. Ouch. 20 years after that, however, in the 1979-1980 season, playing in the UEFA Cup, which is now, of course, known as the Europa League, they made it all the way to the final where they faced Borussia Mönchengladbach. At this time, the final was a two-legged affair. Frankfurt lost the first leg 3-2 in Mönchengladbach. Those two away goals would prove vital, however, as Frankfurt got the 1-0 scoreline they needed in the second leg in order to win their first European Cup on away goals. And by European Cup, I should say Europa League / UEFA Cup. Not to be confused with big years. The following season, they continued with their glory, winning the 1981 DFB Pokal. 7 years later, in the 87-88 season, they did it again, and that was that. And that's also where we'll jump ahead to the 2010-2011 season after three relegations and promotions since 1995, and Eintracht Frankfurt are struggling under their manager Michael Skibbe until he's finally sacked on March 22, 2011. Christoph Daum is brought in as the caretaker manager with the tough task of righting the ship before it goes down to the second Bundesliga. He couldn't. Unlucky, Chris. In steps their new manager Armin Wey, fresh off of consecutive seasons managing VfL Wolfsburg and Hamburger SV, and hired with the expectation of guiding Eintracht Frankfurt back to the promised land, the Bundesliga, the real one, not the second one, and he smashed it, as Eintracht Frankfurt went on to finish in second, 2 points behind Greuther Fürth. Remember those guys? In their first season back in the Bundesliga, we're now in the 2012-2013 season, they smashed it again, finishing in sixth and qualifying for the Europa League. Things were looking good under Wey at this point, and in the 2013-14 season, they topped their Europa League group, but lost out to Porto in the first knockout round, the round of 32, on away goals. The task of managing a domestic and European campaign was a little too much for Frankfurt, and they finished in 13th. They improved upon this under Thomas Schaaf during the 2014-15 season, as Armin Wey had left for Stuttgart. Under Schaaf, they finished 3 points outside of the Europa League qualifying in 9th. But with the return of Armin Wey for the 2015-16 season, things didn't go so well, as Eintracht Frankfurt found themselves plummeting towards a fifth relegation since 95. That is, of course, until Wey resigned on March 6, 2016, and Niko Kovac stepped in to save the day. Now, at this point, Frankfurt were in 16th, occupying the relegation / promotion playoff spot. Three wins on the bounce got Kovac and Frankfurt up to 15th with one match remaining. Needing a win against Werder Bremen, Frankfurt conceded in the 88th minute and were condemned to the playoff against Nurnberg with a spot in the Bundesliga on the line. The first match ended 1-1 in Frankfurt, a scary sight for their fans as Nurnberg took an away goal with them to the Max Morlock Stadion. But come the 66th minute, and Haris Seferovic scored the only goal of the match, ensuring safety for Eintracht Frankfurt. On June 1st, 2016, it was announced that Freddy Bobic would be the new director of sport at the club, an extremely important signing for them. And here's where things started to turn around. Here's where they went from nearly relegated to becoming the Frankfurt that you know today. Speaking about the job he had inherited, Bobic told ESPN, quote, "Our net transfer budget was 2.5 million euros. Nothing. Our only chance was to look abroad. We couldn't afford any Germans." Their most expensive signing that summer was fullback Taleb Tuatha for 1.2 million euros. Omar Mascarell cost them 1 million euros from Real Madrid, but their most important signings were on loan, such as Ante Rebic from Fiorentina or Jesus Vallejo, again from Real Madrid. Niko Kovac also changed Frankfurt's system and attitude. Instead of playing to survive, they played to win, with some sort of variation of a 3-4-1-2 providing defensive solidity when without the ball, as they clogged up the center of the pitch. Then, they would press with enthusiasm, their hard-working pressing style becoming a hallmark of their time under Kovac, and they would counter swiftly upon regaining possession, often punishing teams before they could even react. The system worked. And going into the winter break of the 2016-17 season, Frankfurt were sitting in third place. A terrible second half of the season would see them drop to 11th, however, but their DFB Pokal run provided plenty of optimism. Playing the final in Berlin, as per usual, against Borussia Dortmund, no shock there, a 67th minute Aubameyang penalty was all that separated the two clubs in a 2-1 Dortmund victory. But Bobic and the board had further tricks up their sleeve going into the next season. Quote, "We are really interested in players who haven't quite made it yet. We believe we're a club that helps players activate their potential. We provide them with a platform to perform if they show the right mentality and are willing to really make the next step. But it's up to them to deliver." Sébastien Haller was signed from Utrecht for 7 million euros. Luka Jovic was signed on loan from Benfica with an option to buy him outright for 12.5 million euros after his 2-year loan. Kevin Prince Boateng signed on a free transfer. Jonathan de Guzman arrived from Napoli for 1 million euros. Rebic extended his loan for another season, this time with an option to make the move permanent for just 2 million euros. All of these moves were shrewd, yet they were still bringing in players who had shown so much promise in the past, but were forgotten at their current clubs, or players that had been given up on. In other cases, like that of Boateng and de Guzman, players who are longer in the tooth but bring a ton of experience to the table to synthesize with the younger, rawer talent on the team. So, with the DFB Pokal final loss fresh in their minds and with a revitalized squad, Frankfurt went into the 2017-18 season determined to improve, and they did so with a much more consistent Bundesliga campaign where they ended up in 8th, led by Rebic, Haller, Jovic, and Boateng in the attack. Oh, and they had a run to the final of the DFB Pokal once again, this time against Bayern Munich. At this point, it had already been announced that Niko Kovac would be taking the Bayern Munich manager job in the following season, so the DFB final proved to be his last awkward hurrah against his future employers. The performance was the very essence of Kovac's Frankfurt, bunkering down defensively and hurting Bayern in transition, with Rebic scoring the winner in the 84th and Gacinovic added a third in stoppage time, a 3-1 win for Frankfurt. Kovac leaves them with an incredible going away gift, their first trophy since 88, and Frankfurt have qualified for the Europa League group stage. That summer, again following their newly adopted way of doing business under Bobic and the rest of the board, further important signings were brought in, such as Filip Kostic on loan with a 6 million euro option to make the move permanent. Gonzalo Paciencia was bought from Porto for just 3 million euros. Their former keeper Kevin Trapp returned from PSG on loan with an option to make it permanent for 7 million. Later, Martin Hinteregger and Sebastian Rode would join in the winter window on similar deals. All of these players play important roles in the season to come, while veteran players that had been there for a while, such as Makoto Hasebe, also came to be repurposed positionally, but important all the same. None more so, however, than the man who was tasked with being the manager that followed Kovac, Adi Hütter. Having coached with both RB Salzburg and Young Boys before, Adi Hütter brought with him a much more attacking style of play than Kovac employed with the same group. With this change in approach, the results weren't great to start the season, losing 3 of their opening 5 matches. But once things clicked into gear, Frankfurt were the perfect mix of the hardworking past under Kovac, while the attacking play courtesy of Hütter sent Frankfurt as high as 3rd, and later on an unbeaten run of 11 matches once they returned from the winter break. On top of that, their Europa League form was something to be proud of, making it all the way to the semi-finals before losing in a shootout against the eventual champions, Chelsea. Not too bad. It's amazing to see a turnaround of this magnitude by a club of this stature. One league title and half a dozen German cups doesn't exactly make them a German football powerhouse, thus making their transition from relegation to promotion to near relegation once again, a transfer budget of just 2.5 million euros and a run to the Europa League semi-finals and a second consecutive year in a UEFA competition all the more impressive. Frankfurt has been a shining example of buying smart, giving players a chance to achieve their potential, and working the transfer market in a different way in order to get your club back on track. And it's paid off on the pitch, of course, but also off of it. With the sales of Sébastien Haller and Luka Jovic bringing in 100 million euros in profits, not to mention the money made from their deep run in the Europa League. With the acquisitions of further players that haven't met their potential yet, such as Andre Silva, Dejan Jovelic and Jibril Sow, as well as more proven, experienced players like Bas Dost, the Eintracht Frankfurt way continues on, and you wouldn't put it past them to continue with this upward trajectory. I hope you enjoyed this dive into Frankfurt's inspiring revival. If you want more videos like this, then feel free to hit subscribe, but other than that, thanks for taking the time to watch, and take care. Peace.